Welcome to Annette on America, hosted by Annette Bybee, God-fearing, freedom-loving mother, college professor, lawyer, talking to you about all things freedom, all things America.
Welcome to Annette on America. My name is Annette Bybee, single mom to three teenage girls, recovering, well, practicing lawyer. Not recovering right now, I'm practicing again. I've succumbed. College professor, dealing with the heat, getting through the summer. All right, we have a debate coming up tomorrow. If you're listening on Thursday, it's today. If you're listening Sunday, it already happened. Sorry, it hasn't happened for me yet, so I can't talk about it, except to make some predictions and discuss what's coming. So, but we did have a primary election here in Utah and elsewhere, and I'm not going to get into any details on it other than to say a lot of us were disappointed here. And every time, it seems to me like every time there's an election, I come away mostly disappointed. Mostly sad, mostly disgusted, and surprised. And every time, I don't know why I'm surprised every time, that there are so many ignorant voters out there that don't vote the right way. And as in, they don't vote for the conservative, constitution-loving people. They vote for rhinos. And that's what happened here in Utah, which is a real shame, because pretty much any Republican you put up is going to beat the Democrats. So there's really no reason not to go for the more conservative, principled candidates. You know, it's not like you really need to move to the left much to win the election. And yet, we still had that happen. Anyway, all right, so but let's talk about the debate coming up. So former President Trump has claimed that Biden will be pumped up on drugs to enhance his performance at the debate, including getting a big fat shot in the bleep. His assertions have been dismissed by some segments of the media as campaign bluster, but private doctors to the rich and famous tell the Post, this is a New York Post story, that VIPs often use drug cocktails and other treatments to give themselves an edge before they take the spotlight for a big event. So it's not, you know, our imagination. We all saw Biden at the State of the Union address, and he, you know, seemed pretty awake and with it for the most part. And yet then we see numerous clips throughout the week where he's wandering off, or he's just standing there like a statue and everyone around him is dancing, or not able to put a full complete sentence together. And it's like, this doesn't make any sense. Most of us are pretty much the same all the time, you know, we're either with it or we're not, and we don't deviate much, you know, unless we are on, like, if you're like me and you only get 3 or 4 hours of sleep, then you're not terribly with it. But as long as we get reasonable sleep and we're reasonably healthy, we're pretty much the same from day to day, cognitively speaking, but not Biden. Anyway, these cocktails can include anything from peptide infusion for a boost in brain function, Botox to avoid a sweaty brow, Adderall for enhanced focus, and yes, sometimes even a shot in the bum. I've said this before, but I have a friend who says that he has a friend, you know, you never confirm these things, but that says that Biden's coked up when he does these appearances. You know, not a real big long shot when you think about what his son's into. Postgraduate students, medical students, people who work in banking or finance, Wall Street type people, big real estate moguls, Victoria Korabai, a nurse practitioner and founding partner of Beauté Aesthetics in New York City, told the Post. They just need that energy and not the side effects of caffeine and illicit drugs. Biden, 81, and Trump, 78, are both competing to be the oldest person to ever be elected president. When they take the debate stage Thursday night, voters will be scrutinizing the candidates for any sign of weakness or cognitive decline. Modern medicine can do amazing things to enhance performance in pressure cooker environments. Here's what a presidential candidate looking for a boost might take before a big night like the first presidential debate on CNN. Peptides for clarity. Korabai said VIP clients who need to be at their sharpest mentally often seek treatments like peptide infusions. I've never even heard of this before. Peptides are small amino acid chains that occur naturally inside the body, with each type playing different roles in various biological functions like muscle growth, digestion, hormone production, and tissue repair. There are also peptides that support cognitive function. Those things have actually been proven to have a side effect of easing the mind and giving more clarity when someone is speaking. They find their words more easily, is what our clients tell us over and over again, Korabai said. Peptides are often given via IV infusion. Who knew? Who knew there was this whole cottage industry of stuff to give people when they need to be sharp? NAD therapy for anxiety. Another favorite treatment among the powerful and well-healed is nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide therapy. Okay. NAD therapy, which is known to ease anxiety and reduce stress. NADs are coenzymes that, again, naturally occur in our bodies, and our cells would be unable to generate the energy they need to function without them. NADs work on your cells at the basic level and can really impact your brain cells, personality, and cognitive areas. People who have been on heavy doses of ADHD or anxiety medication are finding they can set them aside and end up feeling much better, Korabai said. As for what effect these treatments typically given intravenously would have on a couple of 80-year-old politicians, the hope would be that it would help them feel more naturally calm and be more articulate, Korabai surmised. Botox for sweat. In the era of 100-inch 4K TVs, the candidates' physical appearance during the debates will also be an area of consternation for their respective teams. Too much sweat under the bright studio lighting could telegraph nervousness or weakness, like Richard Nixon learned the hard way in 1960. But modern medicine has found a way to treat flop sweat. Botox. You might use Botox for sweating a week before. You inject them around the hands, the feet, the forehead as well to decrease the amount of sweating when you're under the hot lights, Dr. Howard Sobel, a dermatologic surgeon at Lenox Hill Hospital, told the Post. You saw what happened to Giuliani, he said, referencing the former NYC mayor's infamous November 2020 press conference where his profuse sweating caused a dark streak of what was believed to be hair dye to run down his cheek. Oh boy, not a good look. Vitamin B12 shots for energy. Other last-minute boosts might include vitamin B infusion drips, which can increase the health of brain function and increase energy as well. The doc says the drips, it's a quick pick-me-up. You can do it the day before, and people mix it with other vitamins. Injections of vitamin B12, often given in the rear end or upper thigh, also provide a range of potential benefits for the candidates, from increasing energy levels and combating fatigue to helping improve focus. And then there's Adderall. Long abused by students at all-night study sessions in college dorms, which Trump has named specifically in his speculation about Biden's debate prep regimen. What does it do? Improves listening skills, helps someone pay attention and seem more alert, attentive, and less sleepy, said Sobel, noting that the pills take effect within 30 minutes and last for about 7 hours. I guess kind of like the little blue pill, only you don't like want that to last for 7 hours. And then there's Profagil to fight sleepiness. Another prescription drug, Profagil, I don't know. Decreases excessive sleepiness, Sobel added. To be clear, none of these treatments is illegal, and neither medical professional has provided any form of care to either Biden or Trump. However, if either politician was seeking a boost to weather the rigors of what is sure to be a bruising rematch, there's a veritable apothecary worth of options at their disposal. So I heard that Trump wanted to have Biden's blood tested before the debate, but That's never going to happen. Just like we're never going to be told the truth about what it is that they dope him up with before he goes out to these speaking engagements. That's never going to happen. Anyway, it'll be interesting to see how awake, alert, cognitively on his ball Joe Biden will be tomorrow night during the debate, or tonight if it's Thursday for you. And we have talked before about how this, this is a bizarre election year. We've got people, both Biden and Trump are hated equally. You know, I don't know if I'll call myself a hater, but definitely very much dislike. If I had to categorize myself as hating anyone, it'd probably be closer to Hillary. There's just something about that woman that just rubs me the wrong way. It could be that shriek of hers when she laughs, or it could be that she just makes women look bad. I don't know. So many things to dislike about her. The dishonesty and all those rumors about how she suicides people, just a lot. Biden's terrible too, but he's almost a joke. You know, I'm not joking. Not a joke, Jack. But a full fourth of all voters have unfavorable feelings toward both Joe Biden and Donald Trump, which is the highest number at least since 1988. So that's a lot to hate both of them. In the modern era of presidential elections, particularly with primary races coming earlier and earlier, oftentimes the candidate embraced by a party upon clinching the nomination in the spring becomes November's albatross as the excitement wears off. The buyer's remorse manifests itself in fewer volunteers and contributions and makes the down-ballot contests more difficult for that party. Oh, by the way, we're still waiting. There's supposed to be a big announcement, which is probably going to come tomorrow from Trump about who he's choosing for his VP. And I did a little poll on my Facebook group page. So if you go to Annette on America Radio Show on Facebook, you can participate in this. And I said, who will Trump's VP pick be? And I've got Burgum, and he came in at 20%. Rubio didn't get a single vote, 0%. Scott got 40%. Vance, 0%. And then I had someone add Gabbard and Carlson, even though that's not on Trump's shortlist right now, at least not what he says. Although, you never know with Trump. He really is a wild card. He can come out tomorrow and say someone we're not expecting. I saw another story that Vivek Ramaswamy is going to be at the debate tomorrow night, and that supposedly the VP pick is going to be there. So it could be him, right? I would like it. I would not mind at all if it was Vivek. But anyway, 20% Gabbard, 20% Carlson. So it was a three-way tie between Burgum, Gabbard, and Carlson, with Scott running well ahead. If you were a Democrat, you would say it's got to be Scott because you need a person of color on your ballot. Anyway, go to the Facebook group and add your vote. All right, so but what if many people in both parties feel this way? According to the Axios poll released this month, a full quarter of voters have unfavorable feelings about both candidates, the highest number since at least 1988 when George H.W. Bush ran against Michael Dukakis. Remember that? Oh, man, that was a long time ago. As they opine, the closely watched bloc has nearly doubled in size since 2020, making this fall's Trump versus Biden rematch the most dreaded election in modern political history. Yeah, I haven't thought about the fact. I thought about the fact that so many people have Trump derangement syndrome, and so many people hate Biden because he's doing a terrible job and because he's old and mentally handicapped. But I never thought about the fact that there are so many people that hate both of them, which is interesting and understandable. All right. And that's an important point. While Donald Trump has maintained his share of never Trump voters through all three of his elections, the negatives from Joe Biden come from his poor performance and his advanced age, like I just said. The latter is the reason the media keeps reminding us that Trump recently turned 78. They have to keep reminding us because they don't want us to see there's much of a difference between the two, right? Even though we can see it all the time. Although we probably won't see it much at the debate because of what I just talked about. He's going to be doped. Biden will be doped. The double hater voter block was the main focus of a lengthy Washington Post piece that looked at voters in the small town of Hudson, Wisconsin, soliciting their opinions on the race. In Hudson, the Post reports, voters repeatedly mentioned both Biden's and Trump's ages as a concern, though many described the issues as more acute for Biden than for Trump. Otherwise, many voters cited either Biden's handling of the Israel-Gaza war or the economy as reasons they were loath to support him, while they said their reluctance toward Trump largely stems from issues of character and behavior. Again, this is already baked into the cake for Trump, who has long been known for his willingness to shoot from the hip. Regardless, this buyer's remorse has been apparent since both candidates clinched their primary victories back in March. At the time, Joshua Green at BW Daily posted, in the latest Bloomberg News morning consult poll of swing states, 52% of respondents said Biden is too old, while 59% said Trump is dangerous. In that same time frame, ABC News did its own series of voter interviews with double haters, but noted in the ABC Ipsos survey from earlier in March, when they asked if they'd trust Trump, Biden, or neither to do a better job leading the country as president, 36% of Americans said they trust Trump to do a better job leading the country as president, while 33% trust Biden more, and 30% trust neither. That is huge. While the unusually large share of voters hating their choices, the strategy is simple. For the Democrats, as expressed by AstroTurf Indivisible Group, they claim our strategy for 2024 hones in on two key voter groups, likely Democratic voters who are at risk of staying at home and double hater voters who have negative opinions of both presidential candidates. You might have already come across some of these folks among your friends, family, or neighbors. These are exactly the people we need to reach. For these hard left Democrats, their key issues are, of course, abortion and preserving, quote, our democracy. So when you hear someone talking about preserving our democracy, that's code for Trump is Hitler. And also J6, right? J6 was a threat to our democracy. So that's what they're always going to hit. On the other hand, the Republicans are going to borrow from a famous Democrat and say it's the economy, stupid. There's a reason it's called Bidenflation. And if that weren't enough, there are several other issues where voters demand a change. Illegal immigration. Yes, to me, those are the two biggest that are going to be what the Democrat or Republicans are looking at. The economy and immigration. So illegal immigration and its effects on crime and the economy, a failed foreign policy, and the two-tiered justice system that sees the Republican nominee convicted of trumped up, pun intended, charges, while political malfeasance allows Biden and his fellow Democrats to skate by. So yes, I agree with that. Even though everyone's missing the biggest issue, because it doesn't feel real in our everyday life, and that is the national debt. But what we see daily is inflation. We all know that we are paying a lot more for everything. Groceries, gas, rent, everything. Everything is more. And when you can buy less with what you earn, it affects you daily. And then immigration, depending on where you live, affects you greatly. And if you don't live someplace where you're affected by immigration, you're concerned that you at some point will. And you're also concerned that illegals are going to vote and sway elections. While there is a third-party candidacy of Robert Kennedy Jr. to consider, it's doubtful he will affect the race to the level of, say, Ross Perot in 1992. Even so, Democrats especially are trying to minimize Kennedy's presence, even denying him Secret Service protection as a presidential candidate. And that's just beyond the pale, really. CNN tried to explain that away by claiming a CNN review of presidential campaigns dating back to 1980 found that only then Senator Barack Obama, who faced unique threats as a black man with a realistic chance to become president, was granted Secret Service protection as early in a campaign as Kennedy is seeking it. We would posit that Kennedy faces the unique threat of possibly denying the Democrats another term. That is a huge threat. Coupled with his family's awful history of assassination, the denial of Secret Service protection seems utterly vindictive. We have a lot of double haters now, but with the stakes as high as they are, they'll likely hold their nose in November and vote. Let's pray they choose wisely. So, yeah, again, like I said last week, this campaign, this election right now is up for grabs still, as crazy as it is. And I think this just adds another reason. We have double haters that hate both candidates. And we are in an evenly split country. And I'm just guessing that these double haters, when they do hold their nose and vote, are going to be evenly split. And they're going to just vote for whoever belongs to the party they belong to or the party that they lean towards. Because as I've mentioned before, people can call themselves independent all day long, but they still lean. Everyone leans. There's a very small percentage of people that don't lean, and they're just weirdos. Did I ever tell you about the neighbor I had that told me that she didn't like Bush because there was something in Laura Bush's eyes that she didn't like? So there are actually people out there who make their political decisions based on things like that. All right, so speaking of Biden, here's another flip-flop. When you have no principles and you just put your finger up and lick your finger and you put it up to see which way the wind is blowing, then you can flip-flop all day long, and that's Biden. So he issues a mass pardon for gays booted from the military after voting for that ban in the 90s. President Biden issued a mass pardon today to veterans punished by the military for engaging in same-sex relationships, even though he voted as a senator for a law that banned gays and lesbians from the armed forces. Isn't that something? I'm sure he's just enlightened now, right? It has nothing to do with the fact that the LGBTQ wing of the party is extremely loud and that this is June right now. Biden, 81, announced the clemency ahead of joining pop star Elton John at the Stonewall Inn Friday in Manhattan to celebrate the 55th anniversary of the modern gay rights movement. I, Joseph R. Biden Jr., do hereby grant a full, complete, and unconditional pardon to persons convicted of unaggravated offenses based on consensual private conduct with persons aged 18 and older under former Article 125 of the Uniform Code of Military Justice and of attempts, conspiracies, and solicitations to commit such acts, even though I voted for it, Biden wrote in the pardon proclamation. Okay, I added that part about him voting for it. We can't give an exact number, but the administration estimates that there are thousands of individuals who were convicted of consensual conduct and who may therefore be eligible for the pardon, a Biden aide said on a press call. This is a historic injustice, and the president is therefore taking this historic step to ensure that we live up to our sacred obligation to care for all service members, veterans, and their families. Biden, who caused this, or helped to cause this historic injustice, is hunkered down at Camp David for a full week of preparations ahead of Thursday's CNN debate against former President Trump. A full week ahead, because some of those shots and things, they start early. You need to start those a week ahead of time. And he did not address the mass pardon publicly or remark on his own culpability for historical discrimination in the military. While Senator Biden voted in 1993 for the legislation that enshrined the final iteration of the Pentagon's ban on gay and lesbian members, known as the Don't Ask, Don't Tell policy, which despite its name still allowed for service members to be expelled and punished if they were outed against their will. The military's ban on gay and lesbian members ended in September 2011 after bipartisan legislation passed Congress in December 2010, terminating the policy following a review period. Both Biden and Trump, the presumptive Republican presidential nominee, have courted gay voters ahead of what's expected to be a close election decided by thousands of votes in a handful of swing states. with former President former First Lady Melania Trump hosting a log cabin Republicans gathering at the Mar-a-Lago Resort in Palm Beach, Florida in April, and set to host a similar event next month at Trump Tower in New York. Biden has had a mixed political record on LGBT rights. He was one of 32 Senate Democrats who voted in 1996 to federally ban same-sex marriage. I'll bet you he conveniently has forgotten that. No joke. Biden also voted in 1994 for a proposed rule to bar schools with federal funding from advocating the promotion of homosexuality as a positive lifestyle alternative. Isn't that interesting? Boy, here we are 30 years later and we've done a total 180. If you've listened to this show for a while, you'll know that, and here, of course, I'm already almost out of time on this half, but my daughter was attending a middle school, not last year, but the year before, where in the yearbook, there was a two-page spread about gay flags. And the definition or the explanation about what each one of those flags meant. And I thought, what in the H-E double hockey sticks does this have to do with education? And it was highly inappropriate. And I pulled my child from the school the following year. And we went from not wanting to promote homosexuality in the school 30 years ago to celebrating it and promoting it. Yep. Anyway, so flip-flop, and let's pretend it never happened. Let's just pretend that we've always been totally cool with gays in the military and with promoting homosexuality and transgenderism, et cetera, in our schools. And on that note, I will be right back.
Listen to the Sunday segment with WJJ. You'll be blessed with gospel music, special guests, and so much more. That's the Sunday segment with WJJ. Don't miss it. Only on 1220 AM KLDC.
That's right. This is WJJ. Join me on Sundays at 3 p.m.
This is Carter Conlon. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 to 13. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Paul urges us to rely on God's power and wear his armor. We battle spiritual forces, not people. Earthly conflicts are influenced by powers of darkness. Fight against this spiritual wickedness. Speak for God's kingdom, empowered by truth. Even the least of us can make a difference. Talk about it today. It's time to pray.
Dr. Charles Stanley on The Christian Life.
If you have developed patience in your life, there is a sense of quiet stability because you've learned that God is in control of your life and he causes all things to work together for good to those who love him, to those who are called according to his purpose.
The teaching of Dr. Charles Stanley on In Touch, helping you grow in Christ every day.
In Touch, Monday through Friday at 11 a.m. right here on KLDC 1220 a.m.
The journey to salvation starts with his truth. Uplifting Christian Talk, KLDC 1220.
Welcome back to Annette on America. Annette Bybee here. If you've missed any of this episode or any previous episodes, go to AnnetteTalks.com, YouTube, or even better, Rumble, any podcast provider, and You can listen to all the previous episodes. I believe this is episode 147. So go, if you have not listened to the first 146, you get back there and you rectify that situation right now. Also, if you want to reach me, you can email me at Annette@AnnetteTalks.com. I always like reading emails from viewers or listeners, not much to view at this point, although that may change. Also, if you have a wonderful business or service or business that offers a service or a product and you want to become a part of this program and help sponsor this show and take us to another hour, also email me at Annette@AnnetteTalks.com and we'll talk. All right, so immigration. I mentioned that immigration is, to me, the second most important issue in this election. Third, really, if we include that one that nobody really talks about, the national debt, that's, to me, that's number one. And probably gonna take us down. But anyway, if the election, people are looking at inflation, I think number one, and then immigration number two with these foreign wars, Israel, Ukraine probably coming in at number three. Oh, anyway, speaking of immigration, we had a 12-year-old girl killed by an illegal. Every time this happens, though, we have lovely Mayorkas to come out and say it's not a border policy fault. It's not Biden's fault or my fault. It's a criminal. Tone deaf Department of Homeland Security Secretary Alejandro Mayorkas on Wednesday shrugged off attempts to blame Biden's border policy for the horrific slaughter of Americans at the hands of illegal migrants, saying the individual who is responsible for a heinous act is criminal act is the criminal. Well, duh. Okay, yeah. But should that criminal have been here in the first place? We can say that about every crime that's committed by someone who's recently gotten into this country. His comment during a press conference from a Border Patrol agent or aircraft hangar in Tucson, some 70 miles from the nearest border crossing, came in response to a question about 12-year-old Jocelyn Nungaray, who was brutalized and murdered in Houston, allegedly by two Venezuelan migrants who were released into the U.S. earlier this year. Oh, and I read that she had scratches on her fingers where she fought these guys. I mean, 12? My youngest child is 13, and the idea of her trying to save herself from two grown illegal immigrants makes me sick to my stomach. We screen and vet individuals when we encounter them, he said. That's just not true. Oh, when we encounter them. Maybe that's the phrase that he's hiding behind, because how many come through that you never encounter? Because they just slide right by. Border agents quickly responded with skepticism to Mayorkas' claim that the DHS was sufficiently vetting anybody crossing the U.S. border, saying his comments Wednesday show he's living in fairy tale land. I don't know what Mayorkas is smoking because it needs to be legalized, one Border Patrol source told the Post. Maybe he's smoking whatever's getting shot up into Biden's tushy. If by vetting he means fingerprinting and doing some half blank bank background check that has access to almost nothing outside of the United States, then yeah, it's a great process. He defended the border vetting procedures even while acknowledging at least 8 ISIS-linked suspected terrorists managed to slip through U.S. custody and enter the country. Oh, but if those ISIS-linked terrorists do anything wrong in this country, it won't be the fault of Homeland Security or the Border Patrol or the Biden policy. It'll be them. It'll be those ISIS terrorists. The Post first reported on the ISIS suspects being arrested after traveling as far as Los Angeles, Philadelphia, and New York. See, this is why I say most people are concerned about immigration, even if they're not seeing a problem in their backyard, because they know that they probably will at some point. We did not have derogatory information when they were first encountered, Mayorkas said. Concerns were raised subsequently. We used our law enforcement authorities to apprehend and detain them, and then they are in removal proceedings as we speak, he added, in the first press conference about the border since Senate Democrats blocked an impeachment trial against him, effectively acquitting him of the charges. Mayorkas' statement comes the same day that NBC News also reported DHS has identified more than 400 migrants who were brought to the U.S. from Central Asia by an ISIS-affiliated human smuggling network, and that the whereabouts of more than 50 of them are unknown. Oh, no problem, right? 50 migrants that came through from ISIS smuggling ring. Sources said that not only are the background checks limited by many countries' refusal to provide information on their citizens, the source explained, but agents are rarely given enough time to effectively screen people before they have to let them go, usually within 3 days. We run checks, but unless they have an actual database hit or have interactions with law enforcement in the U.S., we really don't know, one source said. So that, yeah, that's brilliant. Of course, most of these people have not had law enforcement run-ins in the U.S. They're coming from another country. An ICE source echoed these concerns, adding that background checks often come back with errors or are totally incomplete. The source said migrants often have to be released before border agents have time to fully see the checks through. Not all checks come back completed or verified due to potential errors in time before a subject could be released, letting a potential criminal into the country prior to being completely vetted, the source said. Obviously, he knows that the vetting isn't working, and the American people know that's a false statement and that he's just towing a political line, said a second ICE source. Shortcomings like those could be responsible for 8 ISIS terror suspects being allowed into the country before being arrested earlier this month. They were only apprehended thanks to an FBI tip-off, DHS sources previously confirmed to the Post. They were only apprehended, they had been in the country for months under surveillance by a joint terrorism task force. The ISIS terrorist suspects crossed the border and were let into the country and were only apprehended thanks to an FBI tip-off. Sorry, that's on there like 3 times. 2 of the migrants had been in the country for months under surveillance by a joint terror. You know what? I don't know what's up with this article. The migrants hailed from Tajikistan, a Central Asian country bordering Afghanistan that's become a hotbed of extremist activity through ISIS. Okay, so here's an idea. Why don't we just not let people in from Tajikistan or Afghanistan or Pakistan or other stands? Why don't we just not? Or at least let's not let them in until we have a complete background check done. Okay? Why don't we just turn them right back around and send them home? In addition to the terror suspects, a string of high-profile crimes against women and girls have been linked to illegal migrants who were released into the U.S. And I'm not going to read more. It's depressing. It's just depressing on so many levels that we have these illegal migrants coming through and not contributing to society and instead attacking people and wreaking all sorts of havoc in places like New York City. Just there's nothing good that comes of this. This is why Trump says he likes legal immigration. And I read earlier today that he wants to give citizenship to migrants who have graduated from college. And at least that's something. At least that's some kind of, I'm open to also if they've served in the military. But to just to let people in when their background check's not even complete? No. So continuing on that, I already covered that. So just thinking to yourself, what's gonna happen with Mayorkas? How is it that he gets away with this nonsense? Well, we have those crazy House Republicans trying to do something about it. They voted to defund Mayorkas' salary in Homeland Security Appropriations Bill. I'm just guessing that Mayorkas probably has some other forms of income because it seems like all the corrupt politicians do. But this is a message that I hope ends up getting sent. The House of Representatives voted on Wednesday to block Homeland Security Secretary Alejandro Mayorkas' salary as part of a larger appropriations bill for DHS. The amendment to withhold the salary was introduced by Representative Andy Biggs from Arizona and passed in a 193-173 vote. Only one Republican voted against the amendment. Go Andy Biggs. I've heard a lot of good stuff about him. The amendment prohibits the DHS from using funds in the bill to pay Mayorkas, but a different amendment that would have brought Mayorkas' salary to zero failed. Taxpayers should not be paying an unelected bureaucrat who was impeached by the House, Biggs posted to X prior to the vote. That's why I sponsored an amendment to this year's Homeland Security Appropriations Act to prohibit funding to be used for the salary of Mayorkas. The move comes after House Republicans voted to impeach Mayorkas over his handling of the immigration crisis on the United States southern border in February. But the Senate refused to hold a trial that would remove Mayorkas from power. The funding bill, which would fund the department through fiscal year 2025, also provided $600 million to complete the border wall that began under former President Trump and blocked the department from paying for abortion and transgender health care for migrants detained at the border. Is that really something that's on the table? Paying for abortion and transgender health care for migrants detained at the border? How's that even a thing? I guess I shouldn't be surprised, but I am. It also included a $3 billion increase in funding from fiscal year 2024. The appropriations bill still needs a final vote in the House on Friday, but is unlikely to be passed by a Democratic Senate, of course. If it does pass the Senate, President Biden has already threatened to veto the measure, of course. But we're sending a big message to you, Biden, and you, Mayorkas. You don't deserve a salary. You're derelict in your duty. All right, we are going to shift gears here a little bit, and we're going to talk about, well, we know that abortion is one of the big issues, but of course Biden is trying to make guns a big issue again, and he's calling it a health crisis, but really it's a political health crisis. Have you ever noticed that when Democrats want to make a political issue out of something, suddenly there is a quote-unquote science behind the decision? Not with biology. Let's not be silly. They deny the science of what a woman is or when life begins in the womb. But the Surgeon General does know what constitutes a public health crisis: guns. Oh, before I move on to that, I also wanted to mention that speaking of, you know, the transgender stuff, did you know that Dr. Richard, aka Rachel Levine, doesn't want any age restrictions on gender mutilations? The Assistant Secretary for Health, who was ridiculously named Woman of the Year, or one of the Women of the Year by USA Today in 2022, objects to any kind of age restriction on transgender surgery. Don't you think that's very telling? If you're so convinced that you have to make transgenderism normalized, that you're willing to mutilate and ruin children's lives, like why would you not be able to wait until these kids are 18? Okay, yeah, it might be more difficult for them to transition, but how about we let their brain mature before we go ahead and mutilate their body beyond repair? You know? What? It just, to me, it speaks of real corruption and willing to sacrifice anyone for your political agenda. And for him, Richard Levine, who looks like Richard, will always look like Richard, who is a dude, is willing to do whatever it takes to try and normalize his dysfunction. I do also have to say that I'm seeing a lot less, and I mentioned this last week, thankfully, a lot less of the LGBTQ crap in this month for June. And maybe partly because I'm living in a much more conservative area. When I go to Target, I don't see anything, nothing, no rainbow stuff. Maybe that was the same here last year, I don't know. But I'm not seeing it online. Last year in February, or last year in June, I couldn't go onto Facebook without seeing a bunch of posts from different corporations who've replaced their little logo with a rainbow flag. Now, I'm not seeing nearly that this year. So I think corporate America got a clue. All right, so quick timeline on this public health crisis for guns. June 11, 2024, Hunter Biden convicted of three felonies related to a gun purchase in 2018. Hours later, Joe Biden spoke at a gun safety gathering. he didn't mention his son at all. Instead, he demanded political action against guns while yet again threatening the American people with the government's superior firepower. Isn't that funny how his son's felony conviction slips his mind when he's talking about this? June 14th, 2024, the Supreme Court struck down an effort by the ATF under Donald Trump to regulate bump stocks without the legislative authority to do so. June 15th, Joe Biden's campaign released an ad accusing Trump of doing nothing to stop, quote unquote, gun violence and recounting all the things Biden has done. June 25th, 2024, U.S. Surgeon General Dr. Vivek Murthy officially declared gun violence a public health crisis. He later says our failure to address it is a moral crisis, which will undoubtedly pave the way for Biden to issue executive actions regulating guns. Evidently, Murthy lied in his Senate confirmation hearings when he promised that he did not intend to use my office as Surgeon General as a bully pulpit on gun control. Another flip-flop. Right? When you're not principled, it doesn't matter. You can flip-flop all the day long. You can have more flip-flops than the beach. June 27, 2024. Joe Biden, this is tomorrow because I'm recording today, or it's today if you're listening on Thursday. Anyway, you get the idea. Joe Biden will debate Donald Trump for the first time. Think Murthy's declaration will come up? So in other words, listen for it. Listen for gun violence being called a public health crisis. I really hope that Trump pushes back on that and talks about other actual public health crises like the social contagion of transgenderism. You know, if you listened to me last week, you heard me talking about the biological male who's pretending to be a female who shot and killed his parents here, not too far from where I live, and then expressed that he was glad he did it, no remorse, hated his parents, and you can't tell me that this transgenderism is just a one indication of mental illness. And to me, it's a public health crisis when it's being spread. It's a social contagion. It's almost amusing to see, but I get you're not going to see that. You're not going to see Donald Trump say that because LGBTQ, TIA, plus, WTF, is a very big, again, loud member of the electorate. It's not a big member. I shouldn't say it's not a large number, but it's loud, and people kowtow to it. To summarize, June isn't just Pride Month. It's also almost amusing to see Biden boast about reducing the murder rate, which is largely a manipulation of statistics, and then his Surgeon General declares an emergency that, in the words of the Associated Press, is driven by the fast-growing number of injuries and deaths involving firearms in the country, and how many of those are suicide. The AP also says, to drive down gun deaths, Murthy calls on the U.S. to ban automatic rifles, introduce universal background checks for purchasing guns, regulate the industry, pass laws that would restrict their use in public spaces, and penalize people who fail to safely store their weapons. Well, I'll be darned if those aren't exactly Joe Biden's gun-grabbing political planks. Isn't that something? Murthy sanctimoniously declared, it is now time for us to take this issue out of the realm of politics and put it in the realm of public health. His declaration does just the opposite by assuming government power it has no authority to exercise. The Constitution puts guns in the realm of natural rights, not public health. Yeah, anytime, I mean, this is very convenient, right? How many things can you call public health crisis and then take it out of the political realm? As for manipulated statistics, Murthy's science is full of it. For one thing, notes gun rights champion David Harsanyi, Murthy even throws in incidents where guns are used in self-defense as a harm plaguing the nation's health. Yeah, that's harmful. There are many other examples, but two stand out precisely because they are typical Democrat political talking points. We see this over and over again. Murthy combines suicides with homicides to make the numbers far higher, and he trots out this misleading statistic. Quote, firearm violence is now the leading cause of death among children and adolescents, unquote. The left media and left-wing anti-gun groups parrot the same thing. So they want you to think that there are a lot more school shootings than are actually happening. I would say a lot of that has got to be gang activity, but also suicide. The problem, that stat involves children's ages 1 to 19. Why start at 1 instead of birth? For that matter, why not include the 1 million or so children killed before birth every year? Simple. The arbitrary starting point eliminates other factors that kill far more children than guns. Arsanyai notes that beginning at birth would mean genetic abnormalities and accidents would be the leading killer of children. Interesting, huh? Why end at 19? Once you're 18, you can legally buy a gun, which sort of skews the stats, doesn't it? Again, Harsanyai says, according to the CDC, the leading killers of children between ages 1 and 14 are vehicular accidents, suffocation, and drowning. So they can't have those stats, right? They've got to cook the books. They got to take it up to age 19. Importantly, an awful lot of gang violence in Democrat-controlled urban areas involves older, fatherless teens. Speaking of gangs, the word gang is nowhere to be found in Murthy's 40-page report, though it did put a spotlight on race. Of the report, the Washington Post says Black people in America face the highest risk of gun-related deaths. That's a remarkably passive way to say that Blacks murder other Blacks at alarmingly high rates. Do leftists somehow think Blacks are unable to make that moral choice? Our culture is, unfortunately, sometimes violent. However, that is largely confined to urban areas, and there are factors far more important than guns. Fatherlessness cannot be ignored, though Democrats do ignore it. The gangs that result from vagabond fatherless teens perpetrate an inordinately large part of the crime and violence, which often goes unprosecuted by Democrat DAs. That crime also involves drugs, though the few times Murthy's report mentions drugs are to show that guns are even more dangerous. He doesn't bother to discuss that someone on drugs or transacting drugs is more likely to use a gun to commit violence. On a related note, a recent study found that daily marijuana use outpaces daily drinking in America. Marijuana is bad news for mental health as well as often a gateway to other things. Murthy would rather limit our Second Amendment rights than do much, if anything, to address the drug and family crises that actually drive violence committed by people with often illegal guns. Remember, gun violence is a left-wing buzzword. Guns don't commit violence. People do, and there's virtually always a reason for it beyond an inanimate object. So yes, guns are not committing the crimes. It's people with guns that are. So why don't we figure out why, instead of trying to take the guns away and then they can just pick up a knife. All right, so of course I am about out of time, but I have got to end with a story from my favorite news source, the Babylon Bee, which never fails to amuse. Trump preps for debate against Biden by going to nursing home and arguing with dementia patients. They show Trump standing there talking to an elderly gentleman. West Palm Beach, Florida. The Trump campaign announced Monday that the former president had begun preparing for his upcoming debate with Joe Biden by visiting nursing homes and arguing with dementia patients. George, you're wrong about lying jello. Nobody likes it, Trump said as he argued with a 94-year-old dementia patient who claims to be constantly observed by Russian spies. It doesn't taste good. Everyone's telling me all the time how much they hate it, and you're telling me they should serve it every day? On day one, I will ban lime jello, and Mexico will pay for it. Elderly onlookers applauded as Trump slammed the dementia patient after suddenly picking a fight with him during dessert time. It's like he's saying what we're all thinking, said Constance Woodrow, a 78-year-old Alzheimer's patient. In another instance, Trump screamed at a World War II veteran until he started crying. Greatest generation? More like lamest generation, Trump quipped, invoking laughs from orderlies. You complain about loud music when people, good people, are trying to listen to jazz. You make me sick, to tell you the truth. But thank you for your service. And this and many such cases, a crowd of old folks erupted in cheers for Trump as he blasted one dementia patient after another. Trump's debate prep is a distinct departure from previous campaign years, when he spent time studying government policy and took part in mock debates against former New Jersey Governor Chris Christie. I spent all my time arguing against a fat man about bridges or something, Trump said, reflecting on past debate missteps. It didn't prepare me at all. Biden is thin and he hates bridges. Sources close to the Biden campaign confirm the president is concerned about this new development leading up to Thursday's debate. Oh no, my ice cream, Biden reportedly whispered as his wife led him away. At publishing time, sources confirmed that if Trump fails to win the presidency, he will be welcome at Shady Oaks Assisted Living. Well, that one was actually, honestly, the humor was more in the headline than in the story. But next week, you'll hear the news about how that debate went. If you didn't watch it, I mean, I sometimes skip those things, but this is going to be too interesting. So, as always, thank you for listening to Annette on America, where freedom lovers gather.
Thanks for listening to Annette on America, and join her again next week as she talks all things freedom, all things America.